And the setup is such that for finite x3, the gauge symmetry is also un minus k over here, so that the symmetries match at the defect. And these classical waves, they depend on x3 in such a way that they decay to zero far away from the defect and that they diverge at the defect. More precisely, the look as shown here. So to find possible classical expectation values for the scalar fields, I have to solve the classical equations of motion. And I do that with the assumption that the expectation value can only depend on the distance from the defect. Then the equation of motion looks like this, where of course this double commutator, it originates from the quartic interactions in N equals 4 super young yields. This equation here, it has a number of interesting non-constant solutions that I will study. And the simplest of them I have written down here. For the simplest one, three of the scalars have classical fields equal to zero, whereas the other three have classical fields that look like this. There's an 1 over x3 out in front, and then there's a k times k matrix in the upper left-hand corner. And these three k times k matrices, Ti, where I was from 1 to 3, they constitute a k-dimensional irreducible representation of SU2. It's easy to show that for such matrices, this equation here is fulfilled. Now, that solution is also known as a Nam pole. It fulfills the Nam equations, and it ensures that the setup is half BBS. This is what the setup looks like from the string theory side. I have my 10-dimensional background with capital N D3 brains, which generate my gauge theory. And in this background, I place a single probe D5 brain, which shares three dimensions with the D3 brains. And of course, these three dimensions, they constitute my co-dimension one defect or domain rule. Furthermore, the geometry of the D5 brain is ADS4 times S2. And I need to require that there's a background gauge field, which has K units of magnetic flux on the sphere. In that way, there are K of the D3 brains, which get dissolved in the D5 brain. And in that way, there are N D3 brains, which emerges on one side of the D5 brain, but only N minus K on the other side, reflecting the difference in the rank of the gauge group on the gauge theory side. Okay, there are actually a number of different setups of this type, and I have listed them in this table. So the one I described is in the first column. It's a half BPS setup, and it involves a single D5 brain. There are also similar setups which involve D7 brains, and they're completely non-supersymmetric. For one of them, the classical fields split into two groups, which each carry a representation of SU2. And for the other one, the classical fields are matrices whose commutators constitute representations of SO5. The geometry of the D7 brain is different in the two cases, but the setup on the gauge theory side is similar. We have a co-dimension one defect which separates two regions of space-time with different ranks of gauge groups. Okay, so now in these defect setups, as I said, one can have novel types of observables, and I will be studying one-point functions, and that mainly from the gauge theory side. Now, once we introduce a defect, we have a new scale in the theory, namely the distance from the defect. And the behavior of one-point functions can be inferred entirely from the symmetries of the system. And that was actually done a long time ago by these people. And what they found, among other things, was that the one-point functions of bulk operators are confined to take this form here, where delta is a kind of formal dimension of the operator, x3 is the distance to the defect, and c is some kind of structure constant that we have to determine. Let me stress that it's not a normalization constant, because the normalization is still given by the behavior of the two-point functions very far from the defect, which has to take the canonical form. Now, due to the non-trivial classical fields, of course, the scalar operators can have non-zero one-point functions already at tree level. And we find these by taking our operators, which in the planar limit are single choice operators, and insert the classical values of the fields. Now we also know that at the planar level, the good conformal operators are rather complicated linear combinations of this single choice operators. So we don't want to do this computation brute force. What we want to do is to find a systematic approach to the computation of one-point functions of good conformal operators using the tools of integrability. And the dream is that we will obtain an exact formula which is valid for any operator and eventually for any loop order. Okay. So let's look at these one-point functions in the scalar sector. So we know from integrability that the good conformal operators in the scalar sector can be characterized as being eigenstates of an integrable SO6 spin chain. That's something which dates back to the famous paper by Minahan and Sarembo from 2002. Now the eigenstates of the integrable SO6 spin chain, they are characterized first by the length of the chain and then by three sets of repeatances, some U's, some V pluses, and some V minuses. And in order to have a good conformal operator or spin chain state, then when these repeatances have to fulfill certain beta equations. And if you know the repeatances, then you can translate back from a spin chain state to a conformal operator. And to compute the one-point functions of the good conformal operators, as I said, we need to do this replacement of the fields by the classical values. And we immediately see that we get this factor of x3 coming out in front, where delta is conformal dimension, which is equal to the number of fields for a scalar operator. And the structure constant that we need to determine now, of course, must be expressible in terms entirely of these repeatances. And we want to understand exactly how. So to do the computation, we reformulate it in a convenient way. Namely, we introduce what is known as a matrix product state, which is associated with a defect. So a matrix product state, it's a spin chain state, or rather, it's a sum over all spin chain states, where each state has a prefactor which is equal to the trace over the corresponding representation matrices. So to compute the one-point function, we have to take the inner product between this matrix product state and the spin and the beta eigenstate. Because what this state does is that it picks out the terms in the beta eigenstates in which the fields occur exactly in this order, and then it replaces them by this trace. So it performs or implements exactly this operation up here. So in this language, the object we have to calculate is simply the overlap between the matrix product state and the beta eigenstate, and then we need to normalize by the norm of the beta eigenstate. Okay. So the question I want to address is, when can this overlap be calculated in a closed form? And I would like to stress that there are quite a number of parameters here. That is the length of the beta eigenstate, which is equal to the three-level conformal dimension of the operator. There are the various beta roots, and in particular, the number of beta roots of the various types. And then there's also the representation label, which can be either an SO2 label or an SO5 label, depending on which setup we consider. So now, to answer this question, we can get some inspiration from some of the classical works on boundary integrability and from some more recent works on statistical mechanics. In this more recent work, it was suggested that a matrix product state should be denoted as integrable if it is annihilated by all the odd charges of the spin chain. And an integrable spin chain is characterized by having an entire tower of conserved charges, and these can typically be divided into those which are odd on the space-time parity and those which are even. So the criterion is that all the odd ones should annihilate the matrix product state. And this implies that the matrix product state can only involve excitations which have pairs of momentum, pairs of excitation which have momentum plus and minus p. And that's basically because all the conserved charges have eigenvalues that basically correspond to all the various possible powers of p's. This fact, the motivation for this criterion is twofold. First of all, it was fulfilled for all the cases where one knew an overlap formula where it was when it was formulated and was basic. That was, among other things, the results of these papers down here. But also another motivation is that if you perform a weak rotation, then this criterion here, it corresponds to the criterion that you have a boundary state which only allows pure reflection. So the excitations, they can exchange quantum numbers and change momentum from P to minus P, but we cannot have a particle creation or annihilation, which is known to be closely connected to boundary integrability. It's certainly a necessary condition for having integrability, but it's not completely sufficient, because we know that we also need that the boundary reflection has to be compatible with the scattering in the bulk, and that is a requirement which is encoded in the boundary correct. Now I hear myself, I don't know what is going on.
Go ahead, one of the participants had the microphone on, so it's muted. Please go ahead.
Okay, so now I can test this simple integrability criterion on the three types of matrix product states that correspond to the three types of setups that I introduced. So the outcome of this analysis is that the supersymmetric D3, D5 probrand setup should be integrable, whereas there's a difference between the two D3, D7 probrand setups. One should be integrable, whereas one should be non-integrable, and that is the product case here with two representations of SU2. Now one can actually, after having performed this test, also find a reflection matrix which indeed fulfills the boundary Young-Baxter equations of the integrable SO6 spin chains and has a proper symmetry. So in this case, the integrability criterion proposed seems to be sufficient. And in the two cases, which are supposed to be integrable, we can indeed derive an exact formula for the one-point functions. So let me flash what the result looks like. So here's a result for the supersymmetric D3, D5 probrand setup. So it's a result for the structure constant, CK, and it depends on a lot of parameters, as I said. And the result is valid for any value of these parameters, any length, any representation label, and any beta roots. So it might look complicated, but actually it's expressed in terms of objects which are well known in the language of integrability. There appears a lot of Qs, which are Baxter polynomials. These are simply polynomials which have the rapidities as roots. And since there are three types of rapidities, there are three types of Baxter polynomials. Then there's also the ratio between two determinants of a certain matrix. That matrix is also well known in the language of integrability. It's known as the Gödel matrix. And it's a matrix which encodes the norm of a beta eigenstate. More precisely, the norm of our beta eigenstate can be written as a determinant of the Gödel matrix, and when the momenta are paired, then that determinant factorizes into a product of two terms, and in this formula we have the ratio between those two factors. Finally, there is an object here which is closely related to the transfer matrix of the spin chain in the k minus one representation. So it's all well-known objects which appear. The same is the case for the integrable SO5 symmetric case. We have an exact formula which is valid for all the values of the parameters, and it is again expressed entirely in terms of Baxter polynomials, the Gödel matrix, and in this case it is somewhat more complicated with a lot of sums over Baxter polynomials. So I should say that these formulas were not found in one single go. They were found in small steps, but both of these full overlaps formulas that I showed, they are by now completely proven. Okay, now you can ask what happens if you go to other sectors and the scalar sector and to higher loops. And now it turns out that the formula that we derived at tree level, it actually works after a few simple modifications. So we know from integrability of the spectral problem, how we in general go to higher loop orders. So first, we fix the matrix structure of the scattering matrix from symmetries. And in that process, we find that to go to higher loop orders, we have to replace the rapidity variables U, which are related to momentum in this way here, by a new variable X that is related to U via a Zhukovsky map that involves the Tuhoff coupling in this way here. Then we also need to fix an overall scaling phase of the S matrix, and we can, if we want, also include finite size corrections via the thermodynamical beta ansatz. But we will forget about these two latter complications because the dressing phase is known only to appear at for loop order, and the wrapping corrections are only relevant for short operators. So it turns out that our formula from before, which I have now restricted to the SU2 subsector of two complex scalars, it still works, provided we do this replacement here in the beta equations and in the transfer matrix. And then we just need to do one more thing. We need to multiply by a flux factor that has this form here. It depends only on the flux parameter K, therefore the name, and then on the one loop anomalous dimension of the operator in question. It's very important and neat that it does not depend on the beta rules. All dependence on the beta rules are already contained in the tree level expression. So now recently, well, I should mention that the way we fixed this flux factor was by a honest field theoretical computation. And it's a somewhat non-trivial computation because you first have to set up the perturbative framework that is not completely standard because you have these classical fields, which are representation matrices and which lead to a mixing between all flavor and color components of the fields of N=4 supernumerals. So you have to diagonalize a rather complicated mass matrix, which is a long exercise in representation theory, but it can be carried out using fuzzy spherical harmonics. And that was basically what we did. But very recently, there has been a very interesting development. Namely, it has been understood how to reproduce this one loop formula by a bootstrap argument. And in that argument, this flux factor, which looked weird in the beginning, it actually originates exactly from a boundary dressing phase. So for the boundary problem, apparently the dressing phase turns up not at for loop order, but already at one loop order. And furthermore, the sum over representations that appeared in the transfer matrix, it originates from a sum over boundary bound states. So that is a very interesting new development, as I said. And in principle, that can allow us to go to higher loop orders as well. I should say that the bootstrap is not absolutely completed, but it's initiated in these two papers here. And by the combination of these two, it should be able to extract a lot of more information about higher loops and other sectors. But here I would like to tell you about a somewhat more pedestrian way to go to other sectors and to higher loops. And that is by going to a special case of the defect setup, namely a case where the parameter k is equal to 1. In the bootstrap formulation, it corresponds to the case where there are no boundary bound states. And on the field theory side, it means that there are no classical fields, no vacuum expectation values, but there are specific boundary conditions at the defect. So here I have written down what my fields look like on the right-hand side of the defect. So if k is larger than 1 or equal to 1, larger than 1, then we have some non-trivial classical field in the upper left-hand corner, k times k block here, whereas all the other components are 0. And exactly for k equals 1, everything is 0. If we then move on to the quantum level, what happens for k larger than 1 is that the fields in the upper band and the left-hand band here become massive with masses in quotation marks, which are proportional to 1 over x3 squared, where x3 is the distance to the defect. What that means is that the excitations or the quantum corrections are effectively described in terms of ADS propagators, where some auxiliary ADS space emerges, which has the distance from the defect as its radial parameter and the defect as its boundary. And the fields are in that way prevented from propagating through the defect. This fields here in the bigger block of the matrix, the set fields, they stay massive and they can move on both sides on the defect. If we go to k equals one, then there's only a single row and this up here and a single column to the left. And what happens is that these fields, well, they don't get masses because we have no webs, but they get specific boundary conditions and the defect. They get either the Dirichlet or Neumann boundary conditions, and it happens in a way that supersymmetry is preserved. And very neatly, you can find the relevant propagators simply by taking the k going to one limit of the ADS propagators from before. The set fields in the big block, they have no particular boundary conditions on the defect. Okay. Now, when we have no classical fields to compute the one-point functions, we of course have to do some honest weak contractions. And therefore, I have written down here what the contraction rules are when k is equal to one. So for the scalars, one can write down the propagators in a unified form. If we introduce a parameter kappa, which is one for Neumann boundary conditions, minus one for Dirichlet, and zero for no boundary conditions. Here it's important that in the second kappa dependent term, the spacetime point x bar, which appears here, is equal to x with a minus sign in front of the third coordinate. And it's also important that when you form the complex field, you have to combine a real field with a Neumann condition with a real field with a Dirichlet condition. Then there's also the fact that you need to pick two field components which live either in the first row or the first column of the matrix field. And when you do that, you find that the contraction rule looks like this, where you get a normal typical delta AB from matrix contractions. Then you get a difference between a Neumann and a Dirichlet propagator. And when you end up with is this expression here, which you notice is non-vanishing, which is normally this for two identical complex fields, and also non-singular. Because if we send x to y, then this denominator here just involves 2x3 squared. You can also write down the appropriate propagators in other sectors. Here I've written it down for the two fermions, which enter the SU2/3 subsector, which is the closest, the smallest closed subsector involving fermions. The propagator in this case involves an epsilon alpha beta, and then some spacetime dependence, which is characteristic of fermionic fields. And one can also, for instance, write down non-vanishing and non-singular propagators for pairs of self-dual gauge fields, which we know constitute a spin one representation of issue two. And from these rules, we can easily compute the one-point functions by performing weak contractions. Obviously, we just have to contract pairs of identical fields. And then we have to optimize the diagram so that it gives us the maximum power of n. So here I have depicted two Feynman diagrams, one which is leading in the large n limit and one which is subleading. And the ring here corresponds to the single trace operator, and the points where the double lines end correspond to insertion of the fields. Now there is one difference from the normal case, namely that we have to make sure that the index, matrix index, which is fixed to one, runs here in the ring, whereas in the internal loops, we have the free index A running so that we get the maximum power of N. So we see we get exactly N to the power L over two, and that combines with the prefactor of the propagators to form this combination lambda over 16 pi squared to the power L over two. And now we can perform the contractions and formulate them as an overlap again between a beta eigenstate and this time another type of state called a valence bond state, which is simply a two-side product state. That is a state which, for instance, for the SU2 subsector can be written in this term in this way here. So it's a product of L over two identical terms of this form. And as before, it does exactly what it's supposed to when you take the inner product with the beta eigenstate. This valence bond state it picks out exactly the contributions to the beta eigenstates where neighboring fields are identical. And then this factor gives a result of contracting those neighboring fields. And we get a factor two in front because you can contract either to the right or to the left in general. And now you can calculate this one-point functional overlap. We can do it analytically for the simplest cases and for the smallest operators, or numerically using Mathematica for more advanced cases. And it turns out that you get a closed expression of factorized determinant form in all these three cases listed here. And an expression of similar form that we had in the scalar sector at tree level. And there's also the interesting result that the answer in the SU2 subsector, it actually agrees with what you would get by naively taking the k going to infinity limit of the Drest tree level formula. And that, of course, gives us the hope that also for the other sectors, the k equals one case, so it will teach us something about higher loops. Okay, let me now turn to discussing the string theory side of the setup instead. So, as I've been doing mainly, I will focus on the D3D7 probe brain system. If you look carefully at that and try to determine how to exactly embed the D3-5 brain in the ADS5 times S5 background, then you find in a semi-classical analysis where you send lambda to infinity that the D5 brain has to form a certain angle with the ADS5 brain boundary, and that the cotangent of that angle is given by pi k over square root lambda, where k is again the flux parameter. So if it's only lambda we descend to infinity, then the brain simply hangs down with a perpendicular angle to the boundary. But if you also send k to infinity, then you can have a situation where the angle is finite. And if you also keep lambda or k squared finite, of course. And you can then also dream that you can not only keep it finite, but also small and expand in it. And whenever that is possible, it should be possible to compare the semi-classical string theory to perturbative gate theory. So we have a certain double scaling parameter which makes this possible. And this was explicitly for the D5 brain setup, which was treated by Nagasaki and Yamaguchi all the way back in 2012. But there's a similar idea which works for the 2D3D7 setups. So in all three cases, one has a certain double scaling parameter which would make possible a comparison between a semi-classical string computation and a gate theory computation. So for the D3D5 setup, which is the one I've been considering mostly, the double scaling parameter looks like this, as I showed on the previous slide. And for the two other cases, we have other double scaling parameters which look similarly and involve some quantum numbers of respectively SU2 and SU5. Okay. Now you can compute the one-point functions of certain operators, both from the gate theory side and the string theory side, namely one-point functions of chiral primaries, and more precisely, traits set to the power L. And it was observed already a long time ago that you find a match for the one-point functions at the leading order in the double scaling limit, both for the D3D5 setup and the D3D7 setup. And more recently, this computation has been extended to two leading orders in the double scaling parameter. And for the D3D5 setup, which I remind you is half BPS and integrable, we find a complete match between the gate theory and the string theory side. And that has recently been understood in a more compact way. Namely, it has been understood how to compute this one-point function by localization techniques and how to reproduce both the gate theory and the supergravity result. That's very nice and basically closes that case. But for the two other setups with the seven brains, we don't have supersymmetry at our disposal and we cannot use localization. But still, we can compare the result of a semi-classical spring theory computation to a gauge theory computation. And we have done that both for the D3, D7 setup, which is supposed to be integrable, and the one which is not integrable. So we find a complete match to two leading orders in both cases, as you can see. And the first case here is a setup which is non-supersymmetric, but supposed to be integrable, and the result takes a nice form. The other case is still non-supersymmetric, but it's also non-integrable. And you already see that the form here is much more involved and seems quite difficult to guess what it would look like in at higher loop orders. But the important point is that we get agreement between the two sides, despite the fact that the setup here is both non-supersymmetric and non-integrable.
5 more minutes.
Thank you very much. Then you can, of course, ask, what if you consider non-local observables instead of local observables? And the simplest type of non-local observable you could think of would be a Maltesina-Wilson loop or Wilson-Dyne. And in the simplest case, you can simply place a line parallel to the defect like that, and you can compute its expectation value both on the gauge theory side using perturbative calculations and on the string theory side using the minimal area prescription. And this has been done for a Wilson line, which is parallel to the defect, as I've shown here. This is a picture of the minimal surface, which has a component both in ADS and ADS5 and in S5. If it's not clear here, the red square is the boundary of ADS, the violet square is the defect, and the green part here is the minimal surface. And also for the non-local observables, one finds match. A complete match at two leading orders in double scaling limit, both for the supersymmetric setup and for the completely non-supersymmetric setups. Now, other Wilson loops one can study in the defect setup, and there have been studied two antiparallel lines and a circle, and that has been with the purpose of looking for interesting phase transitions in the system. It's clear that for those cases, there will be a competition between different minimal surfaces. For the two parallel lines, there can be a surface connecting the two lines, or there can be parallel surfaces of this type here. Okay. That leads me to my summary. So I've considered defect setups with varying amounts of symmetries, varying amount of supersymmetry, and some being integrable, some not. And for the cases which were found to be integrable, we have derived an exact formula for one-point functions, both at tree level and one loop. And in the supersymmetric case, it's even possible to bootstrap the results to all loop orders. And also it should be possible to include finite size effects via the TBA. In the non-supersymmetric case, we have not yet gone beyond the tree level. Furthermore, we have found a complete match between spring theory and gauge theory in a certain double scaling limit, both for local observables and for non-local observables, and both for setups which are supersymmetric and some which are not. And that leads me to my conclusion on my future directions. So it will be important to understand this integrability or non-integrability from the spring theory side. So why is one D3D7 programming setup integrable and the other one not? And why is D3D7 different from D3D5? Furthermore, it would be interesting to see if we actually have higher loop integrability for D3D7. There are some arguments in one of these bootstrap papers that it should actually not hold, but I think it still remains to be seen. Then there's, of course, on the basis of these two recent papers, there's a lot of things one can do to complete the bootstrap and extract information about all sectors and all loop orders. And the derivation of the thermodynamical beta answers is still completely missing. Finally, one could hope to also compute Wilson loops by a localization technique, maybe. And eventually, we would like to make connections to the boundary analytic bootstrap program. That's all. Thank you very much.
Maybe we can unmute our microphones and thank Charlotte for an excellent presentation.
Thank you.
there any questions? I don't see at the moment any hands raised. Ed Witten has a question. Please go ahead.
So the angle between the defect and the boundary,
mm-hmm.
that you mentioned about 10 minutes ago,
yes.
in old models, is that angle really completely arbitrary?
No, it's not arbitrary. We find out how to exactly place the probe brain by solving the classical equations of motions, which we find by extremizing the DPI action.
What I mean is, allowing ourselves to adjust K and lambda, we can get any angle, basically. Doesn't break down.
Between 0 and pi over 2, yes.
I just was wondering if there's some limit, some approximation that isn't valid if we want the angle to be too small. But obviously, mm-hmm. asking, I'm not
there's claiming. There's an issue about the stability of the 7D3 setup. That if this parameter becomes, the inverse of this becomes too large, then the system becomes unstable. But in the perturbative regime, this instability is not reached.
What kind of instability do you mean? Sorry.
The D7 brain is stabilized by the flux, but the flux has to have a certain magnitude before the stabilization is realized.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? Yes, Yifan Wang, can you please go ahead and ask your question? You have to
thanks for the nice talk, Charlotte. Can you hear me?
Yes.
So this is more like a comment regarding your on your last slide about the Wilson loop.
Okay.
So the answer is yes, you can compute the Wilson loop observable in the presence of this D-fiber interface using localization.
Okay.
So there's some work in progress. It'll be interesting to compare that to your integrability results.
Very interesting. Yes, I should have said in many places that we'll hear more about localization and the bootstrap later in the week by Yifan Wang.
Yeah, thanks.
Mm-hmm. Okay, any other comments? Any further questions? Okay, if not, let's thank Charlotte again for an excellent presentation. And if we can again unmute the microphone. Thank you very much. I believe the next session starts at 7 p.m. And I think I will let Jeff explain what it's about. But in any case, that means we have about 13 minutes or so until then. Thank you very much. Have a good evening.